A Philippine congressional panel asks for the Senate's comment on a claim that a Senate employee provided information on the House Speaker's supposedly lavish travel expenses. The claim surfaced at a hearing on the potential franchise violations of a network allied with former President Duterte. RG Cruz reports.
Before the House Committee on Legislative Franchises ended its hearing on Thursday night, the panel decided to send a copy of the proceedings to the Senate so it can comment on the claim of SMNI program anchor Jeffrey Ka Eric Celis about Speaker Martin Romualdez's supposed 1.8 billion peso travel fund. Celis claimed someone from the Senate fed him the information but refused to give up his sources. He admitted to having sources and described the other informant from an enlisted number in his phone.
Government employee po siya, nasa Senate, and upon consultation po, empleyado po ito sa Senado currently.
Due to the revelations of Ka Eric, I think we are treading on very dangerous waters when it comes to interparliamentary relationships with the Senate. Assuming that tama yung sinasabi ni Ka Eric, may naglalabas ng disinformation laban sa mababang kapulungan.
Attorney Ferdinand Topacio, a lawyer for SMNI Honorary Chairman and Religious Group Leader Apollo Kiboloy, but who spoke as chairman of the National Citizens Crime Watch, says the hearing is a form of intimidation.
Nakikita naman natin kung bakit sa Committee on Franchise, hindi sa Committee on Public Information. Pananakot dyan. That is a non-so-subtle warning to SMNI na pagka hindi kayo tumigil mag-criticize ang speaker, ay kakansilahin ang prangkisa ninyo.
But for lawmakers who sought the investigation, SMNI had to be held accountable.
Hindi tama ang ginagawa ng SMNI na pumupustura bilang news outlet, pero nagpapakalat naman ng maling impormasyon.
Pagtukol dito sa talagang deliberate na pag-tarnish ng reputasyon ng isang tao ay hindi naman siguro maganda yon.
The committee will continue its investigation next Tuesday. DBS-CBN tried to get the side of the Senate and House leadership, but they have yet to comment on the matter. RG Cruz, DBS-CBN News.
The Philippine Vice President formally opposes calls to allow an international probe of her father's bloody drug war and for Manila to rejoin the International Criminal Court. Mike Navallo reports.
As the Philippine President and the Department of Justice study the possible return of the Philippines to the International Criminal Court, the DOJ on Friday officially received Vice President Sara Duterte's position opposing such moves.
Yung mga arguments po niya ay very valid, kagaya ng yung jurisdiction, yung complementarity issue, the mechanisms by which we will hold people accountable. Pag pumasok ang dayuhan dito at binigay natin sa kanila yung poder na investigate and to undergo a completely different legal regime, ayaw din natin na masubject ang sino mang Filipino doon sa proseso na yon.
Among the arguments, the difference in the rules on evidence and appeals in the Philippines and those in the ICC. Clavano, however, is still not certain if President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. and Justice Secretary Jesus Crispin Remulla have gotten the chance to talk. For former Senator Laila De Lima, the Philippines rejoining the ICC is the right thing to do. The recently freed senator vows to help the ICC in whatever capacity in its probe on the killings connected to the drug war and the Davao Death Squad. As then-chair of the Commission on Human Rights, De Lima led the probe on the killings in Davao in 2009 when she came face-to-face with then-Davao City Mayor Rodrigo Duterte. She says their probe was extensive, uncovering the involvement of several personalities like Edgar Matubato and Arturo Las Cañas, who later identified themselves as Davao Death Squad members in the Senate drug war probe De Lima launched in 2016.
That Mr. Duterte was behind it all, that he was the one who ordered these men to do the killings, that he paid them through the reward system, that it was the intel funds of the city that was used. So there were ghost employees of the city.
Former President Duterte, his lawyers, and former officials have insisted there was no order to kill innocent drug war victims. The ICC probe covers killings from 2011 to 2019. But De Lima explains the CHR probe in 2009 is still relevant because it revealed how the Davao Death Squad was organized and how it conducted its operations. For now, the Bureau of Immigration says ICC investigators can still enter the country as guests because there's no directive to the contrary.
If there is a court order or they are ordered, blacklisted for being undesirable aliens, if they fall under that category, then saka po natin i-implement. But other than that, if there's no directive and we do not see them as a threat.
As the Philippine government's top officials mull their next move, for families of drug war victims, one thing is certain.
Magbago o hindi magbago, magsasalita at magsasalita ang mga pamilya ng biktima. Dito, saan man makarating, matagal man ang magiging proseso, maninindigan ang bawat pamilyang namatayan. Hindi namin makakalimutan ang mga namatay.
More than 6,000 drug suspects were killed in Duterte's drug war based on the official count. But rights groups estimate the figure could go as high as 30,000. Mike Navalio, ABS-CBN News.
A former Philippine senator believes President Marcos is involved in the lower house chamber's move that urged the government to cooperate with an international probe into Duterte's bloody drug war. Antonio Trillanes says the ICC resolutions filed at the House of Representatives are a result of the cracks in the Uniteam coalition.
Ngayon yung minimension nyo ang tungkol dito sa resolution na ito. Ito ay bunga ng paghihiwalay ng landas ng Duterte camp at ng Marcos camp. Hindi nila sasabihin yan publicly kasi ayaw nilang malagasan ang isa't isa sa kanilang base. Pag sinabi nung isang inaaway na nila yung kabilang kampo, mababawas yon. Kaya kahit na very obvious na, hindi pa rin nila openly dinideclare. Ang sinisisi lang nung Duterte camp ay itong si Speaker Romualdez lang. Alam naman natin historically na ang House of Representatives ay ang kumukumpas dyan ay Malacanang.
Trillanes also asserts the country's judiciary is unwilling to investigate the former president contrary to claims of Duterte's allies.
Itong mga sinasabi kasi nilang functioning naman daw yung judicial system natin ay kaya hindi natin kailangan nun. Hindi po yan ang layunin. Kahit functioning ka dun sa mga ordinaryong krimen, pero in this case, meron ba nag-iimbestiga kay Duterte? Hanggang ngayon, wala yan. Ano? Kasi hindi pwedeng, mga witnesses lang, tsaka biktima kasi sinong kakalabani mo, no? Ang si Duterte na merong ang Davao Death Squad or Duterte Death Squad, no? Unwilling and unable yung ating judikatura na imbestigahan siya.
Top military officials of the Philippines, the U.S., Japan, and Australia conclude high-level talks in Tokyo. The first joint service staff talks discussed opportunities to expand cooperation and uphold a rules-based international order. It also reaffirmed the commitment of the four allies to a free and open Indo-Pacific. This meeting is an offshoot of the Defense Ministerial Summit of the four countries held in Singapore in June. The Philippine Coast Guard inaugurates its new West Philippine Sea Station on Pagasa Island. The upgraded station offers improved living conditions for its personnel. It's also seen as a boost to the Coast Guard's capability to monitor maritime incursions and sea mishaps. National Security Advisor Eduardo Año says the Pagasa Coast Guard Station will help address what he calls China's aggressive and unruly bullying of Filipino fisherfolk and sailors.
Ang behavior kasi ng itong Chinese Coast Guard, PLA Navy, Chinese militias are sometimes unpredictable. They do not adhere to the international order, sa rule of law. Kaya yung sinasabi nyo na gray zone tactics, actually hindi na yung gray zone. It's pure bullying and it's pure illegal. So hindi na yung tinatawag na gray zone. And it's not acceptable in the international order.
The Office of the President hosts a family day for its workers and their dependents inside Malacañang grounds. Let's get more details from our correspondent, Katrina Domingo. Kat, good afternoon.
Hi, Rica. President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. on Saturday treated workers of the Office of the President and their families to free food, medical services, free haircuts, and even a free massage as well as raffle draws, saying that it is the office of the president's way of thanking their staff for their hard work. The chief executive said the two-day family day for those working in the OP is something he learned from his father and namesake, late President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. In jest, the current president said that his father told him not to to be more generous to their staff because while they will overpay them, they will also overwork them. The OP's staff deserved a breather, the president said, because of the long hours they have to render at work. He underscores that without their excellence and without their willingness to serve the public, then the leader of the country would not be able to accomplish the projects that he wants to pursue over his term. The president also thanked the OP's workers, saying that this is their chance to relax from work and treat their families to some quality time, especially now that the Christmas season is here. Erica, this is only one of the many events that are hosted inside the Malacañang during the Christmas season. Last week, President Marcos signaled the start of the holiday festivities inside the palace with a Christmas tree lighting ceremony and the National Gift-Giving Day all held inside Malacañang. Last year, the palace was also open to the public for the Simbang Gabi or 9-day mass leading to Christmas. We are still in a wait-and-see mode on whether or not the president will once again open the palace to the public for this holiday mass and other festivities. Rika.
What else are we expecting, Kat, towards the end of the day? Will there be a concert this evening?
Rika, no word yet with regard to concert this evening, but concerts inside the palace have been held even before Christmas season. Mm-hmm. These concerts are usually held in honor of certain sectors. For example, a concert was held for soldiers. There was also a concert for teachers as well as a concert for national athletes of the country. These are spread throughout the year and not just during December. Rika.
All right. Thank you so much, Katrina Domingo, reporting live. About 40 million pesos worth of prohibited frozen products, including Peking ducks, seized by authorities in a cold storage facility in Navotas. Jervis Manahan reports.
Authorities from the National Meat Inspection Service and the Inspectorate and Enforcement Team of the Department of Agriculture seized around 130,000 kilos of hot meat in a cold storage facility in Navotas on Friday. So-called hot meat are meat products that have not been inspected by a government inspector. Authorities say they received an intelligence report that Peking duck is being sold from the facility. The sale of Peking duck from China is still not allowed in the country due to the bird flu ban. After a month of surveillance, DA personnel forcibly entered the facility.
Pagpasok natin, tumambad sa atin unang-una yung amoy. So kung nakakaamoy lang yung mga camera natin, talagang baka pati mga cameraman natin masusuka.
They found not just Peking ducks, but byproducts of chicken and other prohibited fish and seafood. The owner of the facility was not present, and workers were not able to show any pertinent documents.
25 years na ako dito. Kawawa naman yung mga kasamahan ko dito lahat. May mga pamilya. Sana huwag naman isarado, sir. Magdipapasko eh.
The facility was locked in order to halt operations. The NMIS is reminding the public to be more meticulous in buying frozen meat, especially this holiday season.
Ito po yung dapat hindi na nakakarating sa hapagkainan ng bawat Pilipino. Karapatan po natin ang malinis na karne na kakainin.
The products, worth an estimated 40 million pesos, were turned over to the local government for proper disposal. Jervis Manahan, ABS-CBN News.
The Philippine Internal Revenue Bureau urges taxpayers to avail the digital version of the Taxpayer Identification Number, or TIN-ID. As Andrea Taguines reports, the BIR hopes that with its convenience, Filipinos will no longer resort to fixers and scammers.
Lay handles the BIR requirements of the company she works in, so it's important that she has her own Taxpayer Identification Number, or TIN-ID. She lost her physical ID a few months ago, but she hasn't found the time to get a new one.
Hindi ko siya ma-process kasi malayo ako Antipolo, dulo ako na Antipolo, tas yung ID ko 45, nasa Marikina siya, so napakalayo.
This is one of the issues that the Bureau of Internal Revenue wants to do away with as it launched the digital TIN ID. The BIR announced on Thursday that existing taxpayers can now apply for the digital TIN ID through the Bureau's Online Registration and Update System, or OROS. Since the service is free and more convenient than before, BIR Commissioner Romeo Lumagi Jr. hopes people will no longer resort to hiring fixers or buying TIN IDs from online scammers.
Mayroon talaga kasing pwedeng ma-validate, makita na talaga yung mga TIN number na ito fake kasi wala sa system. So ang ginagawa namin doon, kinakancel yun para hindi na makapag-transact.
To get a digital TIN ID, taxpayers must first fill out the Registration Update Sheet, or BIR Sheet Form S1905, to update their email address and other personal information. Then submit this to their designated revenue district office via email. After receiving a confirmation from the BIR, taxpayers can then create their OROS account, log in from there, and generate their digital TIN ID. The user's personal details will automatically appear, but they still need to upload a recent and clear photo of themselves. The BIR said the use of another person's photo or other unrelated photos will be subject to penalty. Instead of the taxpayer's signature, the digital TIN ID comes with a QR code that can be scanned to verify its authenticity. Users also don't need to print it out.
So you can use yung phone mo. Madali, hindi mawawala, dala-dala mo palagi yon.
But the BIR clarified that even with the digital TIN IDs, physical TIN cards will still be accepted. They can both be used as valid government-issued IDs.
There are several other transactions that can be done online using the OROS, such as the registration of book of accounts or even when securing one's taxpayer identification number. Andrea Taguines, ABS-CBN News. A mixed oil price adjustment await motorists in the first week of December. Estimates show gasoline may increase by as much as 30 centavos per liter. As for kerosene, prices may see no movement or go up by 20 centavos per liter. If this projection holds up, it would be the second straight week of price hike for gasoline and kerosene. But it's not all bad. That's as a liter of diesel are expected to be cheaper by as much as 60 centavos. Bad weather delays a scheduled aerial search for the missing plane in Isabela Province. According to the Philippine Civil Aviation Authority, slippery terrain also complicate ongoing ground search operations. They add an investigation is ongoing to check if inclement weather is a factor for the incident. Authorities say locating the plane is a challenge as no emergency distress alert had been received from the missing aircraft. A Piper 32 aircraft en route to Palanan Town went missing earlier this week. The plane was carrying a pilot and a lone passenger.
Nung mawala itong sinasabing aircraft, hindi ito nag-emit ng signal, ano? No, na ini-expect natin dahil ang bawat small aircraft kung ganyan ay mandated po lagyan na lang ng emergency locator transmitter. Ang function po ng ELD is kung sakaling magkaroon na ng impact, magta-transmit po itong lugar at malalaman natin kung nasa yung aircraft.